A very good afternoon to all the participants and our distinguished speaker. I welcome the wonderful audience for today's Talk 7 of webinar series on electron microscopy titled Processing Structure Performance Relationship of Graphene and its Variance Towards Electrochemical Lithium Storage. I will begin with an overview of CEF, IIT Bombay, which was inaugurated by our late ex-Prime Minister Shri Morarji Desai. Instrumental methods of analysis form an indispensable aspect of any research and development program. The Department of Science and Technology, DST, set up the Sophisticated Analytical Instruments Facilities, SAIF, in different parts of the country. The main objective of setting up these facilities was to provide guidance in acquisition of data using sophisticated instruments. Professor Anil Kottantharail is currently heading our CRNTS department. CEF CRNTS has several analytical instruments and provides measurements to IIT Bombay users and to the users from other colleges, universities, national laboratories, and various industries as well. The current slide shows the list of instruments funded by DST, in which two of the electron microscopes have been highlighted. The one at the bottom is an upcoming facility, a dual beam, focused electron and ion beam, which will be installed soon. Next slide shows the list of instruments which come under the central facility funded by IIT Bombay. Today, we are going to highlight the three transmission electron microscopes. One of them is a conventional TEM and the other two are field emission gun-based instruments with different analytical capabilities. Like the 200 kV FET TEM has energy dispersive spectroscopy attachment with it, and the 300 kV FET TEM has EDS and electron energy loss spectroscopy with it. All are in-house at CEF CRNT. We have created a LinkedIn account for CEF IIT Bombay. We would be happy to connect with you through this mode too. This is the brochure for the webinar series on electron microscopy, which is uploaded to this LinkedIn account. Following slide shows the staff at CEF CRNTS. We would be happy to welcome you at CEF and help you with the sample analysis. Talk 7 in the webinar series on electron microscopy is on processing structure performance relationship of graphene and its variance towards electrochemical lithium storage, and will be shortly given by Dr. Farzana J. Sonia. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome Dr. Farzana J. Sonia. She's a postdoctoral fellow at Nano Carbon Group, J. Herosky Institute of Physical Chemistry, Academy of Sciences of Czech Republic. Her research mainly focuses on understanding the electrochemical metal ion storage and optoelectronic properties of two-dimensional nanocomposites. Farzana obtained her MSc and PhD from Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, after her BSc from Jadavpur University. Dr. Farzana has published and co-authored 14 research papers in international peer-reviewed journals. Her research work has also been recognized and awarded by the Carbon Journal, Materials Research Society of India, and the Material Research Society of Singapore, and IIT Bombay for Best Thesis Award 2019. Farzana's other major achievements include the prestigious Ministry of Science and Technology, DST Inspired Research Fellowship, West Bengal Council of Higher Secondary Education Scholarship, and international travel support through the Indian Science and Engineering Research Board. She is also a recipient of the Gordon Research Conference Carlstrom International Diversity Fellowship and has won Best Postgraduate Awards in various national and international conferences. We are sure that this talk will enlighten the knowledge of the upcoming researchers in the field of electron microscopy and encourage them to use the electron microscopes. Question and answers to be posted in the question and answer box. Questions with participants' names only will be answered. So let us commence today's webinar. Over to you, Dr. Farzana.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Aradhana ma'am, for your kind introduction and the head of the CRNTS department, Professor Anil Katharial, for arranging such a wonderful webinar series. And this is a really great honor for me to be invited in the in this webinar series. So in the previous lectures on this webinar series, we have learned about different microscopic techniques such as ACM, TEM. And today, what I will like to talk about is how these microscopic techniques are used when we want to have some practical applications, such as lithium-ion batteries. So we know about lithium-ion battery. The schematic is shown here also. The batteries, they are consisted of electrodes called anode and cathode. They are separated by some separator layer, and there are some electrolyte. It can be liquid, polymer or solid. Through this electrolyte, lithium shuttles between the two electrodes for the discharge and charge, especially for this rechargeable batteries. For the recent days, lithium-ion batteries, graphite is the most commonly used anode material. This is very good. Graphite is actually very good material for that. It is very stable for multiple number of lithium intake and uptake. However, the capacity of graphite is quite less, and the process of lithium storage in the graphite is also slow. So if we want to have a battery which can store a lot of capacity and it can be charged very fast, then we should search for some material which is capable to have a faster reaction. And for that, graphene is a promising material. It is a lower dimensional part of graphite. It can be a single layer or it can be a few layers. The terminology is till 10 layers of graphene. We call this as few layer graphene. So it can be useful. It can store more lithium. It can store faster also. But the process of lithium storage in graphene is not yet well known. There are quite a lot of confusion we can see in the literature. That may be because of the relation between the structural properties and the preparation routes, and also the link between that two with electrochemical lithium storage is not yet well established. So we will focus on these relationships in today's talk. So to start with the structural properties, the first thing that comes in mind and has a significant impact on lithium storage is the number of graphene layers. So when we go down from graphite to graphene, single layer or few layer, the properties of that changes. And again, as the lithium that sits in between the graphene layers of the graphite when it is get stored, so the number of layers should have a huge impact on the lithium storage. So let us see how that will that effect will be there. We'll talk about this in later slides. So when we prepare some graphene, we need to know how many number of layers is present there. So the first thing that we can use is optical microscopy to have just an overview on that, if the graphene is on some substrate that can give high contrast. But the very useful, but if we want to know exactly the number of graphene layers, then we should go for some spectroscopic or microscopic technique. So the first thing that I should talk about is Raman spectroscopy. It is very sensitive towards the number of layers, and from its G band and the 2D band is very sensitive for the number of layers, and from that we can get to know how many layers is present. But Raman spectroscopy can give us exact estimation on the very thin layers, like 1, 2 or 3. If it is more than 3 layers, then Raman spectroscopy is not that much useful. Then we should go for some microscopic techniques such as TEM, We can do the cross-section TEM, or we can see look through at the edges of the graphene so that we can see the graphene layers properly and we can get to know how many layers are present. Another technique is AFM. We can see the height profile of the graphene, and if we know the interlayer spacing from XRD, then we can get to know how many number of layers is present in our graphene film. Then, as you know, the number of layers, we should see about the other features that has the significant impact on the lithium storage, and I should talk about the structural defect now. Defect comes into account when this carbon atoms are not arranged in proper hexagonal fashion. If some carbon is missing, it can give rise to mono vacancy defect or di vacancy defect, and if they are arranged in some other way, not in the proper hexagonal fashion, then it can give rise to Stonewall's defect or different other defects. We can see the defect from Raman spectroscopy. The D mode is very sensitive. D mode comes for the when the defect is present. And from this Raman spectroscopy, we can also quantify the defect that can be present in the graphene layers. And if we want to see the defects, we should take help of TEM or STEM to see the atoms and how they are arranged. There can be other type of defect also called as extrinsic defect, and that is actually if there are some foreign atoms attached to the carbon for the graphene, then that is called as extrinsic defect. It can be oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, or anything else other than the carbon. So we can use different spectroscopic methods to see these defects. Few are shown here. Again, The another structural feature that has very important impact on the lithium storage is the edge sites. That is because the lithium diffusion in the parallel direction of the graphene planes or graphite planes is quite higher than in the perpendicular direction. So for that, the edges is very important to know. And there can be different type of defects. It can be zigzag or armchair. And if we want to see it, we should take help of STEM. There are few more important features that have that controls the lithium storage, I should say. And the first thing is the stacking. Depending on whether these graphene layers are well ordered or they have some random stacking, they have different structural electronic properties, and also they show different properties towards the lithium storage. We will talk about this very shortly in later slides. Also, the stacking order of these graphene layers have a significant impact on this lithium storage, whether this is ABS stacking, ABC stacking, or they have some random angle between themselves is very important to know. Similarly, the interlayer spacing of graphene, that also matters a lot, whether we have a uniform interlayer spacing or non-uniform interlayer spacing, that gives rise to different phenomenon of lithium storage. We will also talk about this shortly. This is just an example of ACM microscopic images where we could see the stacking order of these different graphenes. Another important feature that we should look through is the specific surface area. When we go down from graphite to graphene, we already increases the specific surface area by orders of magnitude. Again, as graphene is 2D materials, it poses wrinkles on its surface. Because of that, the specific surface area increases again. And the specific surface area, we can have a first guess from the morphology of the graphene, and we can quantify that using some gas adsorption desorption techniques. So after knowing the structural properties that has impact on this lithium storage, we should think how we can control these structural properties. And for that, we need to know the preparation method. Graphene paper, graphene can be prepared by various ways named as top-down approach or bottom-up approach. When we start with graphite and we thin down it to the single layer or bilayer or few layers of graphene, it is well known as top-down approach. And when we start with some carbon atoms, carbon precursor, and assemble them to form the graphene, then it is named as bottom-up approach. So this mechanical exfoliation is the first technique. It is a top-down method which actually gave rise to graphene. Graphene was discovered by this method actually. But this method is very useful to have a high quality graphene, but the yield is so poor for this process that it is not capable for, it is not suitable for uses of the energy storage. And we should talk about the liquid phase exfoliation. One of the example is Hummer's method, where we start with graphite, we oxidize them, we intercalate some molecules or the solvents, and then we separate these layers and we again goes back to the we just reduce it so that we can remove the oxygen functional groups from the surface of the graphene. So this process is named as, like, when this graphene oxide is formed, it is called as GO, and when we reduce it back, we name it as RGOs. This process is very good for large scale application, and it is used a lot for the battery applications. There are different other methods, top-down methods, for example, electrochemical exfoliation or CO force exfoliation. And to talk about the bottom-up method, the chemical vapor deposition, CVD, is the one which is used widely for preparing defect-free graphene layers with the bottom-up method. This process that we have seen here, the CVD and the RGOs, they are mainly used for the case of battery applications. There are other methods also used, but these two methods are used mostly. So I will talk more about these two methods. These methods have their own pros and cons. So we can see from the process that we take for this depositions, for the chemical vapor deposition CVD, there the control on the number of graphene layers is very good. We can prepare from single to multiple layers of graphene with good control. But the control on the graphene layers for the RGOs is not that good, because the graphite is randomly exfoliated and then this graphene are produced. Again, the structural defect that is present for the graphene in CVD produced by CVD method is very less. But the defect, the control on the defect for the RGOs is quite difficult, because we introduce the oxygen or the other functional groups in the graphene layers for separating them out. So for that, the structural defect in the RGOs is quite higher. And in the same reason, because of the presence of these functional groups and their bonding with the solvent or some other molecules, the interlayer spacing in the RGOs is not uniform. There can be some trapped molecule also in between the graphene layers, giving rise to different interlayer spaces at different places. But for the CVD graphene, their very uniform interlayer spacing can be achieved. So with that, we can see that if we want to see, if we want to do the fundamental studies, then CVD graphene is very good. We can directly see what is the effect of reducing number of layers of graphene. But the It is the large scale production is difficult for the CVD, especially for this energy storage. The way we want to store lithium, the way we store lithium in this lithium ion batteries, having CVD graphene for those purposes is difficult. So CVD graphene is very good candidate for the fundamental studies, but if we think about the practical uses, maybe we should think about GEO and RGOs. So I will slowly go through these two different processes of graphene and how we can control the quality of graphene through this. So there are different literature on the control of this preparation methods of CVD graphene. The preparation of graphene varies from for the atmospheric CVD graphene or the low pressure CVD, and if we change the the pressure in the deposition chamber, or if we change the carrier gas or the precursor gas, then again the quality of the graphene varies. So I will just quickly show the graphene that we used for our studies. We deposited it through CVD. It is something like 7 layers of graphene with a very well ordered one. If the GEO or RGO can be prepared very good quality or not, obviously it can be. If we optimize the process parameters in such a way that we can get a very good quality of RGO, yes, it is possible. So we have optimized it. We have shown that we're starting with graphite, going to GEO. We have reduced it by different processes like chemical process or thermal process or the combination of both. And we have shown how these structures of this GEO can be optimized. So we have seen when we have done this thermal treatment on the GEO, we get a very uniform interlayer spacing of the graphene, and also the defect is quite less. But if we use the chemical process for the reduction of GEO and obtaining the RGO, then we can see quite a non-uniform interlayer spacing, and the defect is also quite higher. So to understand it more, we have done in situ XRDs during the thermal treatment of this GEO. And here we have seen that as we increase the temperature, the interlayer spacing starts becoming a very uniform one after some temperature of 400 degrees centigrade. We have tried to monitor this change through the microscopic technique, something like TEM, and we have seen that for the chemically treated RGOs, the interlayer spacing is non-uniform. It varies from places to places, but when we did it for the thermally treated RGOs, we have seen very uniform interlayer spacing. So from that, we can guess the structure of these graphene layers, that when we have chemically treated RGOs, the interlayer spacing is different because of might be the some trapped species which is giving rise to this non-uniform interlayer spacing. But when we do the thermal treatment, after certain temperature, we can achieve a very good quality of RGOs. There are other literature also which shows these things. How this preparation method give rise to different structural properties of this RGOs, and also the for the thermal treatment. By now we have seen how these structural properties can be varied by varying the preparation method. So let's talk about how the lithium storage is also dependent on these properties and the preparation routes. Before going to graphene, I should talk about graphite, because the system of the mechanism of lithium storage in graphite is well documented, and we can use that understanding towards our understanding of few layers or single layer graphene lithium storage on that. So for graphite, they are Naturally, graphite is a BA stacked depending on the sliding between different graphene layers. And when we study the lithium storage in the graphite, we use either cyclic voltammetry or galvanostatic charge discharge. In cyclic voltammetry, we vary the applying potential gradually and we monitor the current change. And in galvanostatic profile, we generally apply a particular current and we monitor how the potential changes. So they are correlated to each other. I will show you how this cyclic voltammogram and galvanostatic potential profile changes when this lithium goes inside the in the graphite, like the when the lithium is get stored by the graphite. So when lithium starts going in between the graphene layers, it starts from the edges of the graphene and it forms some disordered stages at the very edge of this graphite. And when more lithium goes in, then this lithium, the concentration of lithium in between the graphene layer increases, then they order themselves in some proper manner. They form highly ordered stages of this lithium intercalated graphite compounds. So the first ordered phase, it looks like this, and it is named at stage 4 because there are 4 graphite layers or graphene layers in between 2 intercalated lithium layers. And when this phase transformation takes place, we can see a peak appears in the cyclic voltammogram and a plateau in the galvanostatic potential profile. Also, as this lithium tries to go in between the graphite layers, then there is a sliding, relative sliding between the graphene layers, so that and they forms AA stacking, A stacking, so that the lithium can sit in the center of the carbon hexagon. And then when more lithium goes in, the concentration increases, it forms different other stages of lithium intercalated graphite compounds. And at the final stage, stage 1, we can see that one lithium is hosted by 6 carbon atoms. And when they goes out, it gives a reverse peaks and plateaus in the cyclic voltammogram or the galvanostatic potential profile. So once we know the graphite, let's think about how it is the case for the case of graphene. When we have few layers graphene, it's not single layer. Point to be noted, it is few layer graphene. So we can expect that the lithium storage mechanism will be similar to that of the graphite. But in contrast to that, we have seen in different literature that it is not very similar. The study that was done by Yao et al, they have shown that till 15 graphene layers, the intercalation mechanism is different from that of the graphite. Also, the study by Lian et al also indicates that for the case of 4 layers of graphene, it is not very similar to that of the graphite. However, the study published by Polak et al indicates that lithium intercalation takes place in the few layer graphene. They have also observed formation of the different stages by the in situ Raman. What we have observed is, yes, for this few layer graphene, for our case it was 7 layers of graphene, the intercalation of lithium indeed take place and it forms the lithium intercalated graphite compounds. We can see the plateaus and the peaks clearly present in our potential profiles and cyclic voltammogram. So the difference of this can be understood something like so difference that we can see is the graphene that we used is CVD grown, very well ordered, very less defect, and the graphene that we have talked about previously, they are produced by the liquid phase exfoliation, which again indicates, which which indicates that if our graphene is very well ordered and the defect is not that much, then we can see the lithium intercalated graphite compound formation even for the few layer graphene. So we need to have the quality of graphene control if we want to see the exact the only role of lowering down of constituent graphene layers. However, for this few layer graphene, the interesting thing we observed when we tried to see the capacity. We have observed that for few layer graphene, the capacity is 3 to 4 times higher than that of the graphite. So where that extra capacity comes from, we can see through the analysis of CV, the cyclic voltammogram, and there we have seen there is presence of both the surface control and diffusion control process in the few layer graphene. And through the DFT based calculations, we have seen that there is indeed lithium intercalation taking place for the few layer graphene. In addition to that, there are some surface storage lithium adsorption on the surface of the exposed surfaces and also at the edges of the graphene, which can be giving rise to this extra capacity of this few layer graphene. So when we know the lithium storage mechanism for few layer graphene called like 7 layers of graphene, let's see how it is for the bilayer graphene or the single layer graphene. So let's start with bilayer graphene. Again, from this study that we have seen in the previous slide, Yao et al. Has observed that for the bilayer graphene also the mechanism is different from that of the graphite. The study that by Z et al. Indicates that there are indeed formation of some stages of lithium intercalated graphite compounds, but from different microscopic techniques and the DFT based calculations, they have seen that these stages are different from that of the graphite. Kuhne et al. Has observed through in situ TEM that for this bilayer graphene, the lithium intercalation indeed take place and it is capable to form multi layers of lithium in between the graphene layers. So what about the single layer graphene? Let's see. There are different literatures which have different views on this, on the mechanism of lithium storage in single layer graphene. That we can see from this study, the lithium can be stored on both side of the graphene, alternate carbon atoms. However, this research group, they have seen through the DFT based calculations that for the pristine graphene, lithium storage is not possible. It's not thermodynamically favorable. However, if there is some defect present, then it can store lithium. Again, our study indicates that for the single layer graphene, lithium storage on both sides of the graphene is not possible, it's not thermodynamically favorable. However, formation of this LiC6 similar to the stage 1 of graphite is possible. So the difference again might be because of the different techniques and simulation parameters that is used for this calculation of this lithium storage. So experimental studies is extremely needed to understand the single layer graphene, how they store lithium, and that is still missing. Systematic study is still missing in that part. So let's now talk about the structural defect, how they have effect on the lithium storage. So we can see again that I had told in the previous slide that if we have different amount of defect in the graphene, they can be advantageous for lithium storage. We can see again for the studies done by Yao et al. that when we have different type of defect, the bonding between the lithium and the carbon atom, nearby carbon atom, gets different. And because of that, different defects has a different mechanism of lithium storage. When there is there can be more defect, it can form some pores on the graphene layers or the cracks. These cracks or pores can be advantageous for lithium to get intercalated between the graphene layers, and it is capable to show higher lithium storage capacity when this type of structures. Again, for depending on the oxygen containing group on the graphene, it has observed by the research group here that if the oxygen content increases, then the capacity can also get enhanced. However, it is observed by different experimental studies that this type of structures, mainly the GO or RGO, they can give rise to higher capacity. However, the potential profile that can be obtained from the RGOs is quite different from that of the graphite. They are very slopy in nature, showing a lot of surface reactions taking place, whether they are reversible or irreversible. We have shown through our optimized RGOs that if we have a very well ordered RGO, then we can still get this lithium intercalation and formation of lithium intercalated graphite compounds very similar to that of the graphite. This directly indicates that the stacking sequence and the degree of ordering of graphene is very important if we want to really understand the lithium storage in the graphene, or we want to get a profile which is very close to that of the graphite. We can still see from like the different RGOs that we had prepared by different reduction mechanisms, and we had seen that for this chemically reduced graphene oxide, the interlayer spacing is very non-uniform, and for this thermally treated RGOs, the interlayer spacing was very good, very well ordered they are. So the electrochemical performance of these different RGOs is also different. We can see that for the thermally treated RGOs, the obtained capacity is higher compared to the chemical ones, and they are also capable to give rise to faster lithium storage. This shows very flat potential profile even at this very high cycling rates. And we have also seen that when we have our very well ordered, less defective few layers graphene grown by CVD, we can obtain the staging phenomenon can also be observed in that few layer graphene. So let's move on. We can now see how the ages of this graphene is important and how they are controlling the lithium storage. From this study, we can see that depending on whether we have armchair or zigzag type of ages, the bonding between the carbon and the lithium is different. For the case of zigzag, it is quite higher than that of the armchair ones. Also, the diffusion through the diffusion of the lithium through the graphene layers is different for the case of zigzag type of ages or the armchair of ages. We have also seen that the ages indeed plays a very important role in lithium storage of the single layer graphene. When we have these ages, the lithium gets a higher chance to get stored on the graphene, and it can form structures higher than LiC6 that we have shown for the graphite, the final one. So the presence of this ages indeed can help to achieve a higher lithium storage for the single layer graphene. We have also tried to see the bilayer graphenes, and there we have seen that if there is a mismatch of the graphene layers in size for the top layer and the bottom layer, then this type of structure can be formed, which can be called a stepped edge. And this is very very obvious for the practical cases like CVD grown graphene or RGOs. This stepped edges, the formation of stepped edges is very practical. And if we have this type of stepped edges, we can see that there can be enhanced lithium storage also. So the edge sites, presence of edge sites for the lithium storage is very, very important. So let us talk about the last one. It is the specific surface area of graphene that have been rolled on the lithium storage. So we can see when this study was done by Jiang et al, they have shown that when we have different RGOs with different surface area, specific surface area, then our lithium storage can also be different. The higher the specific surface area, higher is the obtained capacity. This can be understood in this way, that if the surface area is high, then the contact between the electrolyte and the graphene or graphite enhances. So because of that, more lithium can get stored in the structure. However, if the surface area is more, then there is more chance for the irreversible reactions taking place. We can see that from this lower initial Coulombic efficiencies for the structures having more surface area, and when is the specific surface area is lower, then we can see the Coulombic efficiency for the first cycle is actually higher, indicating that there is less irreversible reactions taking place in this lithium storage, in the lithium storage. So by now we already know that the preparation method of graphene having a very significant role on the structural properties of it, and depending on that, the lithium storage again varies. So to get a well desired high performance lithium ion battery out of the graphene, we need to know the correlation between the structural properties and preparation method and the correlation of all these three. With that, I would like to finish by acknowledging my PhD supervisor, Professor Amartya Mukhopadhyay, Professor M. Aslam, and my current research group leader, Dr. Martin Kalvaj and Dr. Otakar Frank, and also Professor Priya Johari for guiding me through this work. I also want to thank you, my collaborators, funding agencies, my lab members, and very importantly, SAFE IIT Bombay for providing the microscopic and spectroscopic techniques that I have used for this study, that we have used for this study. And also, I want to thank IRCC, CEN for the same token. And also thank you all for your attention and being with me for this webinar. Thank you again.
Thank you, Dr. Farzana. Let's begin with today's question and answer round. The first question is by Dr. Saptarshi Maiti. He wants to know, what are the most essential contributing factors for graphene that will decide its preparation process, particularly for its application in battery storage? Is there any role of C by O ratio for battery application?
Yes, it is a very good question. Thank you for asking this. Obviously, if the oxygen O by C ratio is very high, then the that I showed the extrinsic defects that comes in picture, and if the oxygen is very higher, it can give rise to like according to different studies, it can give rise to higher capacity, but again we have to compromise on the potential profile. It becomes very slopy when we have higher oxygen content in our graphene.
Thank you, Dr. Farzana. Another interesting question is, what are the challenges in recycling of lithium batteries?
Yes, there are quite a few challenges regarding that, because we have the electrolyte that we use for this lithium batteries. They are very explosive. Now, whenever they come in contact with the air, they can form, they can get in to fire. And again, there are different materials which, like the for the cathode, the commonly used cathode by now is the lithium cobalt oxide. It contains the cobalt. So basically, this different materials that we use for these batteries, discarding them is a problem for in the context of environmental issues.
Okay. Mr. Setupathy wants to ask, what is the difference between top-down process and bottom-up process?
So the top-down process is when we start with a thick, very thick bulk graphite, and we separate the graphene layers of those graphite and form the graphene. So that is the top-down method. Generally, if we use a mechanical exfoliation, then we can get a very high quality graphene. But if we are using liquid phase exfoliation or electrochemical exfoliation or few others, then we can have we can get the defect introduced in the structure. When we do the bottom-up method, then we use some carbon precursor and then we produce the graphene. So if we optimize the process parameters properly, then then there is a chance to get a very high quality graphene out of this bottom-up techniques.
Thank you. Another question is by Mr. Kumar Anurag. He wants to know, for electrochemical exfoliation, we have to choose solvents whose surface energy is similar to graphene. Why?
I guess this is because when we use this solvent and we try to do the electrochemical exfoliation, then the atom, the ions that is present in the solvent need to go need to get intercalated in the graphene layers, and they can then form the they can then produce this exfoliation. So because of that, the ions getting intercalated in the graphene layers is very important, and because of that, it is needed.
Okay. Mr. Manoj wants to know, what is the definition of few layers of graphene?
Okay, this is, there is again contradictory views on that. Some researchers don't agree with this, some researcher agrees. It is the terminology is when we have the graphene layers from 1 to 10, it is called as few layer graphene. When it is more than 10, it is called as multilayer graphene. But as I told, there is contradictory views on that, because when we have 10 layers of graphene, the properties becomes quite similar to that of the graphite. So not all researcher agrees to call them as few layer graphene. But the terminology is like that. If you have a graphene layers less than 10, then it is called as few layer graphene.
Okay, another interesting question is, which force induces the graphene attract the electron from cathode material while charging, and which force induces the graphene release the electron while discharging?
Okay, yes, indeed, it is a very nice question. So when we have basically for the graphene or for graphite, getting lithium in is not a spontaneous process. When we apply external force, we apply some external energy via applying potential or applying current, then this external force helps lithium to go in between the graphene layers or getting absorbed on the surface of the graphene. And during the charge, basically the lithium that comes out of the graphene, that process is spontaneous. So if we have some graphene filled with lithium and we leave it idle, then the lithium has the tendency to come out of the graphene. It is spontaneously happens.
Thank you. Next question is, which material is going to replace graphene in near future?
This is a nice question, I should say, but the thing is, the graphene is not yet commercially used. So having the graphene as a commercial electrode for the lithium batteries is still needs more researches for that, and replacing that, then maybe we should think about other 2D materials, MOS2, WS2. We don't know yet. We should see.
Okay. What are the disadvantages that you came across due to graphene in lithium storage? Is it commercially possible to use graphene in lithium storage?
In the last question, that for commercial purposes, the lithium, the graphene is not yet used as an active material. Graphene is used for commercial batteries for the thermal conduction. The product is already there. I guess Huawei has done that, and some projects of Samsung is also taking place for the thermal conduction of the graphene. And the composite of graphene with silicon is still some extent commercialized already, but only graphene is not yet. And the challenges that I observed during my studies is this understanding that, because we have seen that there are different contradictory views present in the open literature regarding the mechanism of lithium storage in few layer or multi-layer or single layer graphene. So to understand that and to come up with the idea how we can exactly understand the sole role of reduced dimensional scales of graphite towards the lithium storage was the main challenge for the study that I have presented here.
Thank you. The list of questions seems to be increasing. Can we use any two-dimensional material for this application? Does TEM help for analysis of intercalation material quantitatively?
TEM quantitatively, maybe not exactly, or maybe yes, I am not 100% sure, but the TEM obviously shows us whether the lithium is getting intercalated or getting absorbed, or how is the mechanism. If we try to do the in situ TEM, it is extremely useful technique. Yes. Sorry about the first question, I just forgot. Can you please repeat for me again?
Can we use any two-dimensional material for this application?
Okay, yes. 2D materials, there are a lot of 2D materials that has been discovered very recently, and they are very promising, because when we have 2D materials for the lithium storage, then the process of lithium storage should be faster. We can expect that. So for that, if we use different 2D materials, something like MOS2, WS2, that they are well known, there are a lot other 2D materials that are being checked or experimented with lithium for the case of lithium storage. So there are a few studies on this 2D materials, lithium storage, yes.
Okay, nice question. Dr. Rohini wants to know, the increase in oxygen content in the graphene oxide, the capacity increases, the slide 23. So is this because of the irreversible consumption of lithium for SEI layer formation?
If we want to see, yes, it is a very good question. If we want to see whether the process of lithium storage is reversible or irreversible, then we should check both the charge and discharge cycle, and we try to see the Coulombic efficiency, which is Coulombic efficiency is actually ratio of lithium getting absorbed or intercalated, and the one that is that we can take out. So we should see how much we are putting in and how much we are taking out. So we can see through the Coulombic efficiency. So we have observed, like from the different literatures and also from our studies, that if we have higher oxygen content, then the surface irreversible surface reactions increases, and because of that, it can give rise to higher capacity, but it cannot give rise to higher reversible capacity.
Thank you, Dr. Farzana. Another question is by Kiritiga. She wants to know, does magnetic materials have some specific role in batteries?
Okay, so if we see that lithium is not a magnetic material, and if the magnetism have any role or not in the lithium storage, we need to check that. I don't think any direct relation has been checked till now by any group.
Okay. What are your ideas for the research students?
If we want to understand the system of this lithium storage, or if we want to increase the lithium storage in some system, be it 2D or 3D or graphenic material or any other material, we should first understand its properties and how these properties are getting affected by its preparation method. So understanding that is very important. When we understand this connections between the structural properties and its preparation methods, whatever method we use for that, if we understand that relation, then enhancing their performance in lithium ion battery becomes easier. So that is my message for the research colleagues who are working in different materials for these lithium batteries.
Thank you, Dr. Fazana. Over to you, Mr. Nilesh.
On behalf of SAFE CRNTS, I would like to thank Dr. Farzana Sonia for an interesting talk on processing structure performance relationship of graphene and its variant towards electrochemical lithium storage. We are really grateful to Dr. Farzana Sonia for answering the questions. I would also like to thank our head, Professor Anil Kottantharai, for his continued support in this webinar series. And last but not the least, I thank all the participants for attending this webinar and making this event successful. A link for the feedback form is shared in the question and answer section. Please fill the form. Your valuable inputs are important to us. The registration link for next webinar is now open on our website. The upcoming talk is on atomic scale analysis of indium arsenic quantum dot heterostructures by transmission electron microscopy by Dr. Poonam Murkute. I request you all to join us for our next talk. Once again, thank you all for making the webinar successful. Stay healthy and safe.